Good morning. It's my pleasure to discuss today the most updated information about diabetic kidney disease. It was a pleasure and honor to chair in this valuable conference in Kuwait. So today I'm going to present the harvest of more than 320 articles in the field of diabetic kidney disease, and I'm going to stratify them into 10 corners. I'll start with why diabetic kidney disease is a very important topic, and then what about the pathophysiology with the development of diabetic kidney disease, and how diabetic kidney disease presents, what is the target glycemic control in these patients, is A1C is a good monitor for glycemic state in the presence of diabetic kidney disease, what about the use of antihyperglycemic drugs in managing diabetic kidney disease, what about antihypertensive drugs, novel therapies, and the decisions and the choice of renal replacement therapy in managing diabetic kidney disease, and I'll end with conclusions. To start with, why diabetic kidney disease is a very important topic, because as you see here, the cost of management of diabetes is expanding, reaching more than $80 billion in 2013. And the management of chronic kidney disease also is expanding. So a lot of cost exerted in managing diabetes and kidney disease. A lot of comorbidities associate type 2 diabetes with renal complications. As you see, hypertension, anemia, dyslipidemia, and you can read the proportion of patients who have these complications. And you may find one person with multiple comorbidities. Again, this is a very important disease because it is costly and associated with many comorbidities. And one of the comorbidities is the cardiac and renal vascular complications in type 2 diabetes. Why this disease is important? Because as you see from the current United States Renal Data System report, that the leading cause of end-stage kidney disease in the United States is still diabetes, as you see in this curve, because diabetes is the leading cause of end-stage kidney disease, and it is almost doubled within this period of time. Not only that, but if diabetes is added to chronic kidney disease, hospitalization with acute kidney injury increases. So it is very important disease. Even in the Black American, the presence of the cocktail of diabetes mellitus and the chronic kidney disease increases the incidence stroke, incidence coronary disease, and cardiovascular death. And this is also from the current report of United States Renal Data System. If you find combined diabetes and the cardiovascular disease, you'll find here a lot of deaths within the different stages. The higher the stage of chronic kidney disease, the higher the impact of the presence of diabetes and the cardiovascular disease. And this is, if we shift it to a country of a middle income like Mexico, you'll find this study included 50,000 men and 100,000 women, 35 years of age or older, into a prospective study in Mexico City. In Mexico, here, if you look to the categories of age, if renal dysfunction is present, mortality, the rate ratio increased significantly, as you see in this figure. So the presence of chronic kidney disease with diabetes are associated with high cost of treatment, a lot of comorbidities, and excess mortality. This is why this sector of diseases is very important. What about the pathophysiology This is one of the working hypotheses looking at the topic of diabetic kidney disease in a global view. We have genetic, epigenetic, metabolic dysfunction and metabolic even memory leading to stresses. So you can find glucose dysregulation mediated changes, inflammatory cytokines, fibrogenic alterations, epigenetic reprogramming. All these abnormalities can lead to development of kidney disease in diabetes. And this is the concept of metabolic memory. Even after controlling the hyperglycemia, a lot of problems still constitute a basal genetic mechanism for the development of diabetic nephropathy and fibrosis in the kidney. This is why we should look at the period of diabetes. We should start earlier. The correlation of insulin resistance with CKD progression. Here, if you look either in type 1 diabetes or type 2 diabetes, the presence of insulin resistance is associated with the faster progression of kidney disease. So we should think of that. And there is a crosstalk between different organs and insulin resistance. So in insulin resistance, you can find abnormalities in the brain, in the gut dysbiosis, and the microbiome abnormalities, and liver. At the end of the day, hyperglycemia, hyperinsulinemia as a reflection of insulin resistance, the presence of subclinical inflammation, dysregulated adipokine pattern, dysregulated hepatokine pattern, both all these pathophysiologic mechanisms in lead at the end to vessel and the kidney, vascular and renal dysfunction. The ages advanced glycation in the product pathway. This is a very nice study showed that berberine here exert renal protective effect by regulating ages because it blocks the ages, so it stops the pathophysiology or ameliorate the pathophysiology toward the renal fibrosis. The role of vascular endothelial factor is very important because too much or too little vascular endothelial factors are associated with kidney dysfunction. And as we know, the presence of drugs that target vascular endothelial growth factors constitute a very important class of anti-cancer therapy. And this class of drugs is associated with kidney dysfunction and thrombotic microangiopathy. So again, vascular endothelial growth factor is very important. So too much or too little, and even the different isoforms and the method of blockade by the anti-cancer, as I mentioned, species, metabolic milieu, and the podocyte action of this class. All these are important in the context of pathophysiology. This study shows that the adiponectin is high because in diabetes with vascular abnormalities, there is a state of adiponectin resistance. This is why we may think in the adiponectin pathway to improve its function. Macrophages and inflammation, as we know, we have two types of macrophages. M1, which is an inflammatory macrophage, and M2, which is anti-inflammatory. The inflammatory macrophage, which is marked by CD68, increases with the development of, if you compare here the control versus no diabetic nephropathy in diabetic patients and with evolution to diabetic nephropathy, in diabetic nephropathy, the level of M1 is even more and more, and the ratio may be 2:1. M1 to M2, and these inflammatory macrophages lead to inflammation. Another pathway, which is myonicetyl oxygenase in diabetic kidney disease. If we look here for the mitochondrial control, if the cell is impregnated in normal glucose, you'll find by the confocal microscopy normal rod-shaped mitochondria. But if the cell is exposed to very high level of glucose, you'll find the rod shape of mitochondria is changed into this circles with dysfunctional mitochondria. And the LC3 by immune fluorescence is an index of autophagy. Here in the normal glucose state, the autophagy is within the normal strength, that is diminished in the hyperglycemia. And the as you see the all these parameters that refer to oxidative stress and apoptosis are increased in the presence of hyperglycemia. So the presence of hyperglycemia is associated with reduced autophagy and drop in the mitochondria. And this is why mitophagy and the use of MITO-Q, which protects the mitochondria from oxidative stress. Here this is the mice model, and here the use of MITO-Q improves serum creatinine, decrease albumin creatinine ratio in comparison to the experimental group, and all these parameters are ameliorated with the use of MITO-Q. MITO-Q also reduces mesangial scoring and reduces tubular damage score. Metabolomics in diabetic kidney disease is very important, and this is maybe considered as the silent killer. So we should look at the metabolome, even total bilirubin. Bilirubin is a very important mediator against oxidative stress. So this is why if we find the low bilirubin, this is a state of oxidative stress excess. So in a patient with low bilirubin, we may predict and we may expect the progression of kidney disease. So low total bilirubin is a mediator of and is considered as a predictor of evolution of diabetic kidney disease. How diabetic kidney disease presents? It may be silent at all, and we may find no proteinuria, nothing. And in this issue, we need a good biomarker. This is a study that shows the use of urinary cytokine profile like interleukin-6 and interleukin-10 may be of value in this situation. This is a nice study including data for 6,000 patients in the United States, addressing a very important question: have the clinical manifestation of kidney disease among adults with diabetes changed over the time? By looking at the data here, looking at albuminuria during the different period of time, you find there is decreasing in the incidence of albuminuria for patients with age less than 65 and for patients with age above 65. So the reduction in albuminuria, and in the same moment increasing in the issue of low estimated GFR. This means that it seemed that the presence of diabetic kidney disease, the prevalence is the same, but changing its appearance from albuminuric to low GFR state. So we have two presentations, albuminuric and non-albuminuric diabetic kidney disease. The characteristic of non-albuminuric diabetic kidney disease, as you see, it is more common in females, and non-albuminuric is associated with lower high blood pressure, lower percentage of hypertension in comparison to albuminuric, because here 66% of patients have hypertension, and here 90% have hypertension. And hemoglobin here is significant, and uric acid is higher in albuminuric in comparison to non-albuminuric. So there is even different clinical and laboratory characteristics between albuminuric and non-albuminuric. The most important point is that we have two categories, albuminuric and non-albuminuric coronary kidney disease. Even we may even look at non-albumin proteinuria, and you consider non-albumin proteinuria is a simple and practical predictor of progression of early stages of type 2 diabetes nephropathy, as shown in this study. There is a high percentage and of the prevalence of depression with diabetic kidney disease. Here, this is the white bar reflects the absence of the depression, no depression, and the gray one means mild depression, a black one means moderate to severe depression. With evolution of diabetic kidney disease or diabetic nephropathy, the higher the stage of diabetic nephropathy, the lower the prevalence of no depression, and the higher the prevalence of depression, either in mild or severe form. Renal biopsy in diabetics is currently very crucial, because this is a meta-analysis of 48 studies showing that the presence of non-diabetic related pathology in a diabetic patient is prevalent in renal biopsies. This is a very fantastic case report. It shows that the patient with end-stage diabetic kidney disease may present with giant retinal pigment epithelial tear associated with a fluid overload. So we should be careful about fluid overload in diabetic patient. The question about the target glycemic control, according to the 2017 standards of care, we have two crucial and important parameters and the goals of treatments. They are, we should optimize glucose control to reduce the risk or slow the progression of diabetic kidney disease, and this is a level A of evidence, and optimizing blood pressure. So the management, the most crucial parameters in managing diabetes is to start early by optimum glycemic control and optimum blood pressure control in diabetic patient. This is a very important question that was targeted in the European best practice guidelines, that the question, should we aim to lower A1C by tight glycemic control in patients with diabetes and chronic kidney disease, stage 3B, this means low estimated GFR, less than 45 ml per minute. The answer from the guidelines is, guidelines don't recommend tight control in the presence of stage 3B chronic kidney disease. And the most important point, when we have evolution of kidney disease for higher stages of chronic kidney disease, is to avoid hypoglycemia. So if we start early in the management of diabetic patients, our target is to optimize glycemic control by intensive management. But if chronic kidney disease develops, especially if it is above stage 3B, we should think of avoiding hypoglycemia, because hypoglycemia may be fatal and associated with worse outcome in diabetic kidney disease patients. This is the color code, that here the green color means the concept of low risk of hypoglycemia, and this is a moderate risk of hypoglycemia, and this is the red corner referring to high risk of hypoglycemia. So the use of metformin, alpha glucosidase inhibitors, DPP-4 inhibitors, incretin mimetic, TCDs, sodium glucose transporter 2 inhibitors, all these drugs are associated with low risk of hypoglycemia. Short-acting sulfonylurea derivatives, or sulfonylurea derivatives with inactive metabolites, or the use of meglitinides, all these are associated with moderate risk of hypoglycemia. If the patient has a stage 5 CKD, This means estimated GFR is less than 15 milliliters per minute. This is a state of high risk of hypoglycemia or the use of long-acting sulfonylurea with active metabolites or the use of insulin. So should be careful when we are in this red corner about the development of hypoglycemia. This is the ACCORD trial looking at the CKD from the baseline. We have no CKD in 6,000 patients, CKD in 3,600 patients. Here they look at the issue of intensive glucose control. In non-CKD, intensive control is better, but with development of CKD, it is not better to target glycemic control. And the long-term benefit of intensive glucose control for preventing end-stage kidney disease advance on this the study, including 8,000 patients, participants. And if we look at these data for the long term, the number need to treat here, if we are in stage 1 and 2, you'll find 109 patients to avoid end-stage kidney disease. And the blood pressure is 140, this is 120. So the main message, if we start earlier, in the early stages of chronic kidney disease, intensive control is valid and important and to be adopted. But with higher stages of chronic kidney disease, there is no benefit of intensive glucose control. What about the use of A1C? A1C is not an accurate measure indicating glycemic control in chronic kidney disease. Why? Because of a lot of problems in the CKD environment. Acidosis, anemia, leads to false higher values of glycated hemoglobin A1C, and the use of treatment of anemia give the reverse results. Whatever the reasons, we have alternative modalities like glycated albumin and others, but again, there are pitfalls in the using glycated albumin that should be used more frequent and is not available in many labs, and a lot of causes that leads to false high and false low values are also present with glycated albumin. This is why the guidelines recommend using hemoglobin A1C as a routine reference to assess longer term glycemic control in patients with chronic kidney disease, SH3B or higher, as we see in the guidelines. And if we should put the index of suspicion for diagnosis of hypoglycemia. So the best and the practical way is to look at glycated A1C and to monitor plasma glucose, fasting and postprandial. So monitoring of the glucose and looking at the symptoms of hypoglycemia are of crucial importance. What about the use of anti-hyperglycemic drug? In the presence of kidney disease, we should be cautious about the use of anti-hyperglycemic drug, because one of the major and the giant drug, which is metformin, and here this is the limitation of the use of metformin from the FDA. If creatinine is above 1.5 in men and 1.4 in women, it's better to not to use metformin in this situation. Even if we follow the KDIGO guidelines, we should be limiting the use if estimated GFR is less than 45, and to stop completely if estimated GFR is less than 30 milliliters per minute, to avoid the hazards of gastrointestinal upsets and lactic acidosis. Regarding the use of sulfonylurea, you can read the individual drug, and here glipizides, no dose adjustment required, glimepiride initiate at 1 milligram per day and avoid its use if estimated GFR is less than 60 milliliters per minute. Glyclazide, reduce the dose if estimated GFR is less than 30, and not recommended if it is less than 15 milliliters per minute. Glyburides or glibenclamide, avoid if there is any stage of chronic kidney disease. Meglitinides, ribagliclide, initial dose 0.5 milligram before meals when estimated GFR is less than 30 milliliters per minute, and caution when used, where nitaglenide is used cautiously when eGFR is less than 30. Alpha-glucosidase inhibitor, avoid the use of this class if eGFR is than 30 ml per minute. The pioglitazone needs no dose adjustment, however, their use is not recommended, and we should be cautious because of the high salt and water retention and volume overload in patients with coronary kidney disease. Here, regarding the guideline, addressing the issue of proper use of antidiabetic in the presence of coronary kidney disease, this is the drugs. And if we look at the color code, red color means that the drug is used outside recommendations, and blue one inside recommendations. So if you look at metformin, you can find higher percentage of doctor using this drug outside the recommendation. And this is the glycoside, acetagleptin. So it is better to handle these drugs in a proper fashion and to look at their recommendation of use. Regarding the insulin, there is no advised dose adjustment to whatever the type of insulin. However, we should think of hypoglycemia. So we should look at the pharmacodynamic response. If there is a tendency of hypoglycemia, we may need to reduce the dose of insulin. Regarding the incretin mimetics, liraglutide in this study, including 9,000 patients, the drug is beneficial. And here in end-stage kidney disease, we should be cautious because it may lead to gastric upsets, so we should titrate the dose. This is the long-acting semaglutide that is given in weekly business, so it is very long acting in creatine mimetics, and in this study it is safe, and the new or worsening nephropathy is significantly low in the within the semaglutide group in comparison to placebo. So if we look at the creatine mimetic class and their favorable effects on the kidney, here the the mechanisms of nephroprotection by this class is by avoiding hyperglycemia, proper control of dyslipidemia, reducing body weights, reducing proteinuria, reducing inflammations and fibrosis TGF beta, systemic hypertension, glomerular hypertension. So all these are the mechanisms that inhibited. These are the mechanisms increasing renal progression, and all of these mechanisms are blocked by incretin. So this is why incretin has a favorable renal outcome. Regarding DPP-4 inhibitors, it inhibits the metabolism. They inhibit the metabolism of incretin, and they preserve the incretin. Here, this is the study that shows that sitagliptin, which is DPP-4 inhibitor, is superior to sulfonylurea, and here symptomatic hypoglycemia is significantly lower in sitagliptin, and this is the event of symptomatic hypoglycemia. So it is, in comparison to sulfonylurea, the use of DPP-4 inhibitors is significantly witnessing hypoglycemia. And if we look at the weight gain in sulfonylurea as side effects, by the same amount, there is a drop in body weight and decrease in body weight in the DPP-4 inhibitors. So it seemed that the weight gain is not a problem with the use of this class. And this is a meta-analysis shows that the use of linagliptin is superior to placebo and associated with low kidney dysfunction and nephropathy. And even in the experimental animal, in the 5-6 nephrectomy non-diabetic rats, the use of linagliptin is equivalent to the use of telmisartan. This means that this class is beneficial to the kidney. And for the tacrolimus-induced kidney injury, the use of the DPP-4 inhibitor is associated with lower fibrosis in the tacrolimus treated rats. But the question is, the class of DPP-4 inhibitors a friend class or foe, because there is a variability in the results. And this is one of the explanation of this. This is the mechanism of action. The DPP-4 inhibitors leads to a reduction in TGF beta and inhibition of bad microRNA. So this is a crosstalk with microRNA leading to reducing the fibrosis and nephro at the end of the day, leads to nephroprotection by the use of this class. However, using of this class depends on the context. What's meant by context? Here we have a patient. This is two types of patients. Patients with low activation of chemokine receptor 4 and Y receptor. In this patients with low activation, the use of DPP-4 inhibitors is quiescent for the heart. But when the patient has high activation of chemokine receptor and the Y receptor, they use the blocking of DPP-4 inhibitor, which is the metabolite. DPP-4 is the leads to metabolism of chemokines and neuropeptide Y to inactive materials. So when we block DPP-4 inhibitors with active person in these chemokine receptor and Y receptor, this will lead to preservation of high activation, leading to proliferation and activation of fibrosis, heart failure, and renal dysfunction. So again, according to the context of the patients, if we have a patient with low activation of chemokine receptor, full peptide 1 to 68, and neuropeptide 1 to 36, if these values are low, we can use DPP-4 inhibitor safely because they will preserve incretin, which is very beneficial, and the bad parameters, which are the chemokine receptor and Y receptor, are low, so we are not anticipating a problem from these pathways. But if the patient has high activation of chemokine receptors and Y receptor, the use of DPP-4 inhibitors may be harmful, and in these patients, it is not beneficial. It's not recommended, and it's better to avoid the use of DPP-4 inhibitor in this context, or to use DPP-4 inhibitors with either chemokine receptor blockers or Y receptor blockers. So this will be the new paradigm in thinking and in concepts that should be followed in a more experimental fashion. Regarding sodium glucose cotransporter 2 inhibitors, these are the different classes, different drugs, either monotherapy or in combination. We have canagliflozin, Invokana, and this is the available dose and administration. Canagliflozin, dapagliflozin, empagliflozin, cana metformin, daba metformin, embo glifluzine metformin, embo linagliptin, and you can look at all the members of the sodium glucose cotransporter 2 inhibitors. These are the landmark studies. Here, this is already finished. This is the EMBA Rig Outcome Trial that is published in 2015. And then this is CANA in 2017. And we are waiting the results of these studies that will be published later. Regarding the effects of sodium glucose cotransporter 2 inhibitors, we have, if we look at sodium glucose cotransporter, we have 2 and 1. 2 is present early in the proximal convertibule and is responsible about the absorption in normal glycemic state of 97%. So if we say that there is 160 gram of glucose absorbed every day, so the sodium glucose cotransporter 2 is responsible about 97% of this amount, which is considered 155 gram, and sodium glucose cotransporter 1, which is expressed late in the proximal convoluted tubule, is responsible for absorption of 3% of 160 gram. This means 5 gram per day in a normal glycemic state. Here in the, so this is the mechanism in sodium in the early proximal convoluted tubule and the late proximal convoluted tubule. Sodium glucose cotransporter 2 leads to absorption of sodium and glucose in this segment and absorption here in this segment by the sodium glucose transporter 1. In type 2 diabetes, there is a problem because the diabetes stimulates sodium glucose absorption because it increases sodium glucose transporter expression that leads to high absorption capacity of glucose leading to hyperglycemia. And here in the value of using sodium glucose cotransporter to inhibitor to block this high absorption machinery in type 2 diabetes. If we look at the tubular glomerular feedback, in a normal glycemic state, everything is perfect and the tone of afferent and efferent arteriole within the physiological zone because the sodium glucose cotransporter 2 and 1 work in a physiological manner. So the amount of sodium reaching the distal nephron is perfect and everything is fine. What happens in diabetes? What happens in diabetes, there is increasing the glucose and sodium reabsorption. This means that the there is a low delivery of sodium to jugular glomerular apparatus. This will lead to increasing renin angiotensin system, and it will lead to efferent vasoconstriction. And in the same manner, the decrease in sodium delivery to jugular glomerular apparatus leads to imbalance of tubular glomerular feedback that leads to afferent vasodilatation. So in diabetes, because of imbalance of sodium glucose absorption, there is afferent vasodilatation and efferent vasoconstriction. This combination will definitely lead to hyperfiltration. So when we use sodium glucose cotransporter 2 inhibitors, this will lead to amelioration of absorption of sodium and glucose absorption by proximal convoluted tubule that will lead to increase in sodium delivery to the jugular glomerular apparatus and again resuming the normal tubular glomerular feedback that will lead to afferent vasoconstriction and in the same manner efferent vasodilatation. And by this combination, the hyperfiltration is ameliorated. So one of the most important mechanisms that we should look at by the use of sodium glucose cotransporter 2 inhibitor is to adjust and to ameliorate hyperfiltration. Not only that, but also the use of sodium glucose cotransporter 2 inhibitors lead to increasing the pathway of angiotensin 1 to 7 formation, which is a protective, and to reduce angiotensin 2 formation, which is bad in this scenario. And this is this slide summarizes the potential nephro and the cardiac protective actions of sodium glucose cotransporter inhibition by glycosuria and the reduction of body fat, induction of inflammation, reduction of uric acid, decreasing arterial stiffness, decreasing myocardial stretch, and afferent arteriole. So it will lead to reduction of the ventricular arrhythmias, decreasing intraglomerular hypertension and hyperfiltration. At the end of the day, because of glycosuria and natriuresis, we have cardiac and renal protection. So this is if we look at the feedback and the crosstalk between different organs, this is the action of sodium glucose cotransporter in the kidney with repercussions on the heart by decreasing in blood glucose, decreasing plasma volume, decreasing blood pressure and arterial stiffness, and on the pancreas, increasing the beta cell function, increasing insulin sensitivity on the muscles, and here working on the liver, so a lot of crosstalks by using sodium glucose co-transporter. We have now a concept of KG-A1C paradox. What is meant by KG-A1C paradox? By using of the majority of anti-hyperglycemic drugs, there is increasing weight gain. But by the use of sodium glucose co-transporter inhibitor, there is a weight loss. And this is the actual advantage of the use of sodium glucose co-transporter inhibitors, because increasing weight gain reduces the beneficial effects of diabetic control on the metabolic profile. Do we have an evidence for sodium glucose co-transporter inhibitors and nephroprotection? This is evidence comes from the analysis of the IMBA rig outcome trial for addressing its role of IMBA glufosinate in progression of kidney disease that was published in New England Journal of Medicine on June 2016. Here in this study, the limitation of the use of IMBA was eGFR should be above 30 milliliters per minute to use this drug, either in 10 or 25 milligram, and the result shows that the use of the IMBA was associated with lower probability of worsening nephropathy. So if we look at all renal outcome incident or worsening nephropathy, incident or nephropathy, progression to macroalbuminuria, doubling of serum creatinine, all these are lower in the IMBA arm. This means that the use of IMBA is protective. One of the most recent published study, which is the this study, canagliflozin, slow progression of renal function decline independent of glycemic effects. Here, if we look at the two drugs, glimepiride and canagliflozin, and this is the change in eGFR, you can find the red color refers to glimepiride. Here there's a marked drop of the eGFR in glimepiride. In the same moment, the drop in the there is amelioration of drop of GFR. So it seems that canagliflozin protects the kidney. And if we look here, even if we look globally or to the patients with high urine albumin creatinine ratio above 30 milligram per gram, here the use of glimepiride is associated with more and more drop of GFR. We should look at safety, because safety is very important, and this is one of the studies that shows safety. So we have some concern about the use of sodium glucose co-transporter inhibitors. We know the benefits now: weight loss, blood pressure reduction, uric acid decreasing, lower risk of heart failure, and the cardiorenal protection. But what are the risks? The risk, we are afraid of genetic mycotic infection because of high glucose excretion and volume depletion and euglycemic ketoacidosis, the same mechanism of like diabetic acidosis but without hyperglycemia, because here there is a shift of the use from glucose to lipids, and the bone fractures, especially with canagliflozin. And we have a meta-analysis published shows that this meta-analysis shows that there is no significant fracture, but still in this balance canagliflozin in fractures there may be a link. Reported acute kidney injury because of targeting hyperfiltration, this may be more manifest, and we may find reported acute kidney injury. So we should be cautious about dehydration, and it's better to monitor kidney function in these patients, and especially if the ACE inhibitors or ARBs are used in combination. Again, this is a very recent review showing that the incidence of genital mycotic infection, urinary tract infections, and osmotic diuresis related adverse events were higher in clinical trials, but were generally mild to moderate in intensity. Euglycemic diabetic ketoacidosis related to the use of sodium glucose transporter is pathophysiologically similar to DKA, except for sodium glucose transporter induced glycosuria that artificially lowers plasma glucose level and is predisposed to increased ketogenesis. This is the meta-analysis. targeting the same, the benefits and risk. And here the meta-analysis shows that the use of this class is, at the end of the day, is beneficial and to and the need of many and more studies to below that. Here, this is a very nice case report. This is just a case report, and this is a specimen of, as you see, this is the severe ischemic gut, and this is the resected segment of the intestine, very long segment because of necrosis. And here, the sodium glucose transporter inhibitor was used in type 1 diabetes, so it's better to use this class for type 2 diabetes rather than type 1 diabetes. The metformin here in this study ameliorate the podocyte damage, and in another study the metformin may reduce renal cell carcinoma. And the dogma that metformin increase in contrast induce acute kidney injury was tested in this study in a multicenter study. And if we look here, the contrast-induced acute kidney injury is significantly low in metformin in comparison to non-metformin. So again, metformin is very nice in this study. We are afraid of lactic acidosis. We have two terms in metformin. We have metformin-associated, it is a chronic low threshold acidosis, so this may be asymptomatic. And we have acute lactic acidosis, which is MELA. So we have MELA and MALA. MALA means associated, and MELA means induced. So should be careful about that. And to look at the patient, this is the guidelines for managing of the metformin intoxication and poisoning. If there is severe acidosis and the patient hypotension, BHS7, and lactic acid above 20, all these are indications for dialysis. We may start with intermittent dialysis and then continue therapy until lactate is less than 3 millimole per liter. Regarding the high blood pressure, because as I mentioned, in the current standards of guidelines is to treat hyperglycemia and treat hypertension. What is our goal in the management of diabetes? According to this review, if systolic blood pressure is above 150 in diabetic patient, the use of blood pressure lowering treatment is beneficial by reducing all-cause mortality, cardiovascular mortality, myocardial infarction, and incision disease. If it's between 140 to 150, using the antihypertensive is beneficial, but if systolic blood pressure is less than 140, the use of antihypertensive is harmful and increase cardiovascular mortality, so we should be cautious. The target blood pressure and management is always a very hot topic because it means money, and we look at comorbidities. And the last updated guidelines just published on this 17th of this month by the American College of Physicians, stressing upon the same issues. And this is the Canadian guidelines regarding the diabetic kidney disease. In diabetes, we treat by antihypertensive if blood pressure is above 140. And the inpatient with diabetes, we should use first line drugs like ACE inhibitor or ARBs or calcium channel blocker or beta blockers or diuretics. And there is no superiority for any class of drugs, except if there is proteinuria. If you find diabetes with proteinuria or albuminuria, the use of angiotensin converting enzyme inhibitors or angiotensin receptor blocker is beneficial, and we should avoid using the combination of these two classes. Targeting systolic blood pressure less than 120 is maybe harmful. So if we adopt it, because in stroke patients may be prioritized, we should meticulously follow up these patients and addressing if there is adverse effects or electrolyte abnormalities. If we cannot follow up this patient meticulously, it's better to avoid low target blood pressure in these patients and to be very cautious. Regarding terminology of proteinuria-induced hypertension in diabetic patients is explained in this study, because in proteinuria we may find high level of urine plasmin, and plasmin will lead to activation of sodium channel, leading to a current wave, current sodium. And here, if we look at nephropathy, increasing in blood current, and if we use amiloride, this will inhibit this issue. So in proteinuria induced hypertension, sodium channel, targeting sodium channel by specific blockers like amiloride may be beneficial in this scenario. Is there a novel treatment? This is one of the paradigm using novel mineralocorticoid receptor antagonist, fenironone in diabetic kidney disease. And this is the concept of using this class to reduce, at the end of the day, the renal inflammation fibrosis. And by using this new fenironone, the risk of hyperkalemia is not significant. Another class of drugs, which is ARNI, angiotensin receptor blocker, neprilysin inhibitor, by blocking angiotensin receptor, we will ameliorate vasoconstriction, so it will reduce blood pressure, reduce sympathetic tone, and reduce aldosterone, reducing fibrosis, and reduce left ventricular hypertrophy. And if we block neprilysin, which is responsible about catabolism of BNB, it will preserve BNB and leads to vasodilatation. So, and vasodilation lead to decreasing blood pressure, decrease sympathetic tone, decrease fibrosis, decrease aldosterone. So, by using the combination drugs, we will block the vasoconstriction and we will stimulate vasodilatation. And this is the combination that target aldosterone as well with minimal risk of hyperkalemia. And this is a study showing that the use of neprilysin inhibitor plus angiotensin receptor blocker stimulate improve insulin sensitivity in obesity and hypertensive patients. We are waiting the results of using of this class in coronary kidney disease. And a lot, this slide shows a lot of signaling and the here antioxidative stress. By the way, we have the normal tone of oxidative stress is important for the crucial of the body systems, but high level of oxidative stress and a very low level of oxidative stress, both of them are bad of thinking. So you can look at the all the parameters, all pathways, and the expected treatment. Here I want to target to stress on the some papers that are recently published, like the use of vitamin E as a tool against inflammation and oxidative stress. Probiotics in diabetic hemodialysis patients improve the inflammatory biomarkers. The use of hypericum, perforatum, in experimental model, it has renal protection in rats. The leaf of diosperus also leads to experimental in rats, and we are waiting their testing in human. The using astragalocyte for attenuate podocyte apoptosis. So a lot of issues that needs to be verified in further studies. Vitamin D ameliorate proteinuria in type 2 diabetic patients, especially in the presence of vitamin D deficiency. Regarding replacement therapy, one of the most important questions, because the old dogma is it's better to start dialysis earlier in diabetic, according to the best level of evidence from the systematic literature review, there is no superiority of early or late. So we should individualize our prescription according to the patients. So there is no special recommendation for being diabetic. Here the issue, is it hemodialysis or peritoneal dialysis? The guideline recommend giving priority to the patient to general status and a preference in selecting renal replacement therapy, so either hemo or peritoneal dialysis. And the guideline recommend providing patients with unbiased information about the different available treatment options, and this is 1A. In patients opting to start hemodialysis, the guideline suggests preferring high flux over low flux in diabetic patient. And this suggests diabetes has no influence on the choice between hemodialysis or hemodiafiltration. Regarding transplantation, we shouldn't deprive diabetic patient from transplantation. So if we have type 1 diabetes with end-stage kidney disease, if there is a living donor, we may proceed for preemptive living donor kidney transplantation and to consider pancreas later. If there is no available living donor and there is no comorbidities, the best option is simultaneous kidney and pancreas from the cadaveric transplantation. But if there is a lot of cardiovascular comorbidity, it's better to do cadaveric kidney alone because pancreatic transplantation needs a good health status. Regarding type 2 diabetes, the guidelines recommend against pancreas or islets. So the recommendation is just only kidney transplantation. We shouldn't deprive this patient from kidney transplantation. We should be cautious if we are treating diabetes in a transplant patient because there is many interactions between undiabetic drugs and the immune suppressive drugs, especially cyclosporin in glyburide. And the here you can see the ribagnonide and other drugs. You can look at this article. Regarding the post-transplant diabetes, here when we look at the if diabetes developed after transplantation, and if we look here, if we look at all over the data, you can find here the presence of diabetes before transplantation is associated with lower graft survival, and the presence of post-transplant diabetes is associated as well with poor, significantly worse outcome. And on the multivariate, the presence of diabetes either before or after is associated with increasing risk of graft loss. But when the data is modified and looked at death sensor, so just to look at patients who are surviving, here you can find diabetes lost its significance. So it seems that diabetes affects the survival of the patient that is reflected on the graft rather than affecting graft itself. This from our center experience that hepatitis C is a risk for post-transplant diabetes. A very interesting data about the combination of the diabetic state of the cadaveric donor, because we don't encourage at all, even if there is some countries advocating the use of diabetic donor, we consider diabetes as contraindication for live kidney donation. But in cadaveric, we may find the cocktail. We may find non-diabetic donor or diabetic donor, and we may find a combination non-diabetic donor giving to non-diabetic recipient, non-diabetic donor to diabetic recipient, diabetic donor to non-diabetic recipient, or diabetic donor and diabetic recipient. The worst combination and who attained the lowest graft survival is the if the both donor and recipients are diabetic, as shown here in this curves. The lowest curves are for diabetic pairs. Here, this is from our center, the study of the risk factors and the complication of diabetes mellitus after living kidney donation. And one of the most important messages is to avoid the to educate donors about the healthy lifestyle and to avoid weight gain after donation. Just to conclude, we need to improve the face of diabetic kidney disease. And so we need to know our patients. So individualizing the treatment according to the patient characteristic is very crucial. So personalized medicine is very important. As I mentioned, the BP4 inhibitors, according to the style of chemokine receptors and neuropeptide Y, if these pathways are active, we may think of not giving the BP4 inhibitor or either to use the BP4 inhibitor with blocking chemokines. But if chemokine or neuropeptide Y are inactive, the blocking of the metabolism of incretin and preserving incretin is beneficial, and we can use safely this class of drugs. The multifactorial intervention is very important, crucial, because we shouldn't address only one factor, glycemic state. We should address glycemic, lipid, antioxidant, hypertension, all these pathways. And to indulge the patient in the management, self-control is very important because it is associated with better quality of life. To encourage physical exercise, this is a very nice study, showed that reducing time spent sedentary and increasing overall physical activity may offer intervention opportunities to improve kidney function among individuals with diabetes. And this is the great professor Muhammad Ghunaim, who is the founder of the Urology and Nephro Center, and this is a photo from his presentation of Mansoor Original Research Center and the research in stem cell in experimental animals, and he is the pioneer of this line of research. And I'm hoping that in one day he may reach the secrets of success for translating all his efforts in diabetic research to human. So we are waiting a lot of research. So in diabetes, we need more and more studies to improve research. And this is our virtual academy. I introduce it for all of you because it is very wealthy, including here more than 2,400 lectures and more than 1,200 videos, and a lot of MSQ assignments and exams. At this point, I should stop. Thank you very much, and I'll be happy if you have any questions to send to my email. Thank you very much.